walking around these walls. I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me. Waiting for a change to come, knowing the battle's won.
Come on, how many of us know that we always have a friend that we can lean on? And that friend's name is the mighty one, the strong one, the magnificent one. That friend is Jesus.
Yeah. Good morning, Love AME Church. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We are so glad it's the fourth Sunday of September. That means it's Youth and Young Adult Sunday. So glad to be joined here in the sanctuary by a few youth and young adults. But we're so glad that you thought it not robbery to join us in our virtual sanctuary. We see you, Sister Kimberly. We see you, Sister Lanita. We see you, Sister Tracy. We're so glad this morning that you decided to stop by Love AMB Church here in Largo, Maryland, to worship our God in spirit and in truth. We see you, Sister L. We see you, Sister Sunita. Thank you for stopping by to join us, Sister Debbie, in this virtual sanctuary. Sister Demetria, we see you this morning. We thank you for being here. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Sister Caprina, we see you. Brother George, we see you. Pastor Chris, thank you for being in the virtual space this morning. So glad to worship our God. God has been so good to us. God has kept us this week. God has covered us and protected us in the midst of all that's going on. And we're so grateful just to worship the Lord for a little bit this morning. Without further ado, Agape Praise, take it away.
Come on, say, who am I that?
Who am I that you are mindful of me?
That you hear me.
That you hear me.
When I.
When I roar,
say, is it true that,
is it true that you are thinking of me?
And how you love
how
me,
you love me.
It's amazing,
it's amazing.
And I am a friend of God. Yes, I am a friend of God.
Say,
I am a friend of God.
I find favor in your sight. Then Lord, please, please hear my heart's cry, 'cause I'm desperately waiting to be where you are. And I'll cross the hardest steps, I'll travel near or far for your glory. I will do just to see you, to behold you as my King. Lord, if I find favor,
if I
find favor in
favor in your sight,
Lord, please, Lord, please,
Lord, please,
please what? Hear my heart's cry.
Hear my heart's
I'm desperately
cry.
To be where you are.
To be where you
what will
are.
We do? Cross the hardest.
Cross the hardest desert.
I'll travel near.
Travel near.
Say for your glory.
For your glory.
Lord, I will do.
I will do anything.
Just to see
just
you.
To see you.
To behold you as my King.
To behold.
Be where you are, 'cause peace is where you are, guidance is where you are, joy is where you are, and love is where you are. I wanna be
where you are.
Say, I gotta be where you
gotta
are.
Be where you are.
I wanna be where you are.
morning, church. Please bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for waking up this morning and starting us on our way. Thank you for our lives. We are so grateful to be created by someone as miraculous as you. Thank you for giving us the ability to live each day to our fullest potential. Right now, we ask that you cover this world and all of the people in it. Times are tough right now, and we need you more than ever. Please forgive us for all of our sins and guide us to live your way. Help us to talk to you first in all of our decisions. Lord, please bless all those that are sick and help them to get well. Bless those that have lost loved ones and comfort them through their grief. Continue to bless my church and all of the members. This we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Here are your This Week at Love announcements. Believers Bible Study. Watch it on Facebook Live every Thursday at 7 p.m. Boss Life Bible Study. You don't want to miss this. Join us every Wednesday at 12 noon via Facebook Live for a powerful lunch and learn spiritual message. Daily inspiration. Text Love AME to 545454. That's 3 5 4s to receive the daily inspirational text. Path classes. Have you joined Love AME? And if so, and you haven't taken your 3 path classes, please email lovepathclass@gmail.com and indicate which classes you need to complete. We have First Step 101, Next Step 201, and Big Step 301. Please indicate which classes you need to complete in your email. All right, Love Agents, we have some upcoming events and I'm super excited about it. All login details are located in your This Week at Love newsletter. Join us every Sunday at 9 a.m. to 9:50 a.m. via Zoom for a Spirit-filled Sunday school lesson. Operation Spread Love continues the movement to end hunger. From May to December 2021, Love AME will be the primary distribution facilitator for meals at Capitol Heights Elementary School. Be a blessing. To give any amount to this ministry, visit www.loveamechurch.org/give. Love AME and Taking Effective Action presents a virtual suicide prevention forum. Join us on Thursday, September the 30th at 7 p.m. to bring awareness and prevention to this topic for all ages. To register for this free event, visit www.eventbrite.com. Ladies, October is fast approaching, and you know what that means. That's right. Ladies, this women's season is all about grace. We are celebrating all of us, from the youngest to the oldest, because every woman deserves to be celebrated. Those are your announcements for today. I'm Minister Angelina. Be blessed, healed, and filled with the radiant light of God.
Greetings. I am Reverend Dr. Edna Jenkins. I'm a team member of the Love AME Church Health Ministry. Love AME Church and Taking Effective Action Incorporated, or better known as T, have partnered together to present this healthy soundbite. It's Suicide Prevention and Awareness Month. Today, we'll be talking about the link between mental health and physical activity. We have Ms. Carissa Wells-Bone here with us, who will discuss the importance of physical activity and mental health. Ms. Bone is the founder and CEO of Strategic Mental Health Services, which is headquartered in Sherwood, Arkansas. By the way, she is a resident of Hamilton, Mississippi, Ms. Bone holds a master's degree in psychology from the University of Mississippi and is a licensed professional counselor. And we just want to thank you for joining us today, Ms. Bone.
Thank you for having me.
Can you describe what mental health benefits can result from exercise?
I'd like to begin by defining exercise. We tend to associate the word exercise with something that is laborious or unenjoyable. Exercise is simply moving the body. It can be something as simple as cleaning your house, or it could be something that we traditionally consider exercise, such as running or swimming. We know that the NIH recommends that adults have at least 150 minutes of exercise per week, and a teenager should have at least 60 minutes of exercise per week. And the 3 to 5 year olds, just get them moving every day. We know that when we begin to move our body, that it releases healthy hormones, endorphins. Those are magical hormones that improve our mood. They improve our clarity. These are all recommendations that are within the scope of what your physician says. So seek medical advice before beginning any of this.
How can we encourage people to be more physically active?
Just get moving. And the question becomes, what are you doing? And how can I turn this into exercise? Find what you love and you'll want to do it every day.
We can certainly see that physical activity and mental health are linked together. Thank you, Ms. Bone, for your valuable information.
Thank you so much for having me here today.
Saints, if you had a birthday this week or last week, type "it's my birthday." We have a special greeting just for you. God is love and love is real. Saints, if you had an anniversary this week or last week, type "it's my anniversary" and include the years that you are celebrating. We have a special greeting just for you.
Happy anniversary.
Time that we'd like to welcome all of our visitors to the Love Zone. If this is your first time worshiping with us, please type "first time" and welcome to the Love Zone.
Oh, 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 but the greatest of these is love.
doing the scripture for you for this wonderful morning. Do you see any truly competent workers? They will serve kings rather than work for ordinary people. Proverbs 22, verses 29. Bye-bye.
Saints, it's time to give. We want to thank God for all that He continues to do for us. In season and out of season, God has been good to us. I pray that you would open your heart and allow the Holy Spirit to lead you in your giving for the upbuilding of the kingdom today.
The global pandemic of COVID-19 has required us all to change the way we operate in our daily lives. In spite of these challenges, we know that God is still in control. The mission of Love AME Church to love God, ourselves, and community has not changed. The tithes and offerings of our members and supporters remain critical to ensure the work of the church continues. The communities we serve depend on the faithfulness of your financial gifts. For your convenience, there are several ways for you to safely and securely give. You may go to loveamechurch.org/give and click online giving. You may donate through the Easy Tithe app by searching Love AME Church. You may also text to give. Indicate your dollar amount in the body of a text and send to 301-485-5683. You may donate via Cash App at $LoveAME. Lastly, you may mail your contribution to 1450 Mercantile Lane, Suite 211, Largo, Maryland, 20774. Life is different right now, but God remains the same. We will continue to love God, ourselves, and community here at Love AME Church. We pray for your families, and may God richly bless you during these challenging times.
Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we do thank you for this opportunity to give back to you just a portion of what you've given to us. God, we thank you for your blessings. For all of our blessings have come from you. So we offer back to you just a portion of what you've given to us. Bless those who come today, bringing their offerings, their gifts to you, recognizing that it's you that who has given to us. And we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Bless those who come with willing and cheerful hearts. In Jesus' mighty name.
I got it.
worship you. You are here performing miracles. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, a promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here. I must say he's turning lives around. So what are we gonna do? We worship you.
I worship you.
I worship.
I worship
you who are here.
You are here.
And you're performing miracles.
Performing miracles.
So I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship.
I worship.
Now let's lift this up together. Say waymaker. Waymaker, waymaker,
waymaker,
miracle,
miracle worker,
work, my promise,
promise
keeper,
keep,
light, in the,
light
darkness,
in the darkness,
my God,
my
thank
God,
you, Lord, that is who
that
you are.
Is who you are.
So waymaker, waymaker, waymaker,
waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Amen. Miracle, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper. That is truly who our God is. Grace and peace be multiplied to each of you, my brothers and sisters, here in the sanctuary and there in the virtual space, in the knowledge of God, our Creator, Jesus, our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, who indeed is our comforter. I'm so glad to be back here with the Love AME Church in Largo, Maryland. Thank you to Pastor Chris for once more and again offering me a space to exercise and to operate in my gift. Thank you all for being here today. Thank you for watching us online. Thank you for being with us as we worship God today. I do want to direct your attention to Jeremiah chapter 18. Jeremiah chapter 18 as we go to work this morning. Jeremiah 18 verses, I'm just going to read verse 4. Jeremiah chapter 18 verse 4. From the English Standard Version of the Bible, the word of our Lord reads like this: "And the vessel the potter was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hands. And so the potter reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to do." Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Melt me and mold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. God, fall fresh in this place. God, fall fresh for those who are watching from wherever they are. Fall fresh, God, and help us to feel you. Help us to see you. Help us to hear your word. And help your word, God, to take root in our lives and to do what your word does. Help it to change us. Help it to challenge us. Help it to create within us a new love for ourselves, for you, and for others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For the next few minutes that are yours and mine to share, I want you to think with me from the subject, the potter's process. The potter's process. Beloved of God, through the created order of things, we see God's transformative power. Through the created order of the world, we see God's ability to bring about thorough and dramatic change in form and appearance. That's why I love the butterfly. Through the systematic mechanism of metamorphosis, a seemingly insignificant caterpillar is morphed into, altered and modified into, converted and changed into, literally transformed into a beautiful, splendid, and glorious butterfly. Though it originates in the humble form of a caterpillar, through its transformation process, a caterpillar can become a butterfly. Likewise, one of the oldest and the most enduring forms of art is pottery. And through a process of molding and shaping, turning and pressing, pottery reveals to us a full circle view of transformation. A piece of clay, something that is insignificant, lacking in value, can be transformed into a beautiful piece of art. That is the reality, brothers and sisters, that we all possess the possibility of transformation. However, transformation is never complete without us having endured the fullness of the process. Somebody say process. A people of God, this life that we live is full of systematic mechanisms called processes. We learn this concept of process from a very young age. We learn that in order to reach a certain end or goal or accomplishment, there are things that we have to do and lessons that we have to learn. It's simply called a process. Every day, our bodies are undergoing various processes, including respiration and growth. There are levels and steps to these processes. You can't get to your desired outcome without first going through the process. Those of us who are believers find ourselves in a process called sanctification. Now, all that suggests is that every single day in our lives, we are getting closer to this end goal of being perfect with Christ. It doesn't mean that we've arrived. It doesn't mean that we're there yet. All it means is that we're on our way. We aren't there yet, but we're pushing for progress every single day, trying to get better. As we look into this text this morning, I believe God desires to show us a few things from Jeremiah's experience down at the potter's house. And if you would, let me lay a framework and a background for our text. As we come to this 18th chapter of Jeremiah, we realize that the Israelite people have been torn in two. Their nation has been divided into Israel and Judah. The people have turned their backs on God. The Israelites began to take part in idol worship. They began to marry people from pagan nations. They rebelled against God's law and made the choice to do what was right in their own eyes. Their kings, evil and corrupted by power, led them deeper into wickedness. So God raises up a prophet. God sends Jeremiah with this message to get your houses in order. And Jeremiah tells the people they've got to clean up their act. They've got to clean up their lives and turn back to God, or else they would face some sure destruction. The people, they reject this prophecy from Jeremiah because they've fallen into this pattern of sinning and doing wrong to the point that they fear there's no longer a possibility to change. Rather than trying to change their sin, they cope with it. Rather than trying to be delivered, they settle for balancing. Rather than trying to get rid of the sin in their lives, they try to cover up the sin. They fall into a state of helplessness and hopelessness. And when God realizes that the people have become hopeless to the outlook and to the possibility of change from their sinful condition, the Spirit of God brings an instruction to Jeremiah, telling him to go down to the potter's house. Because there at the potter's house, my beloved brothers and sisters, God intends to show Jeremiah a thing or two about what God is capable of doing. God, knowing that the people have fallen into the trapping of sin, desires to show Jeremiah that God still has power to transform. God still has power to transform even the hardest and most helpless of sinners. So Jeremiah, in this hopeless, helpless state, and I do believe that God desires to offer Jeremiah some hope through this experience down at the potter's house. God will reinstate to Jeremiah a principle. God will present a problem. There will be a revealing through the process, and there will be a peek at the final product. Watch the text. The text says that Jeremiah goes to the potter's house. And when Jeremiah gets there, the potter is working at the wheel. Jeremiah stands in the window and observes the potter, and through silent whispers, God reminds Jeremiah that God is still God. God reminds Jeremiah that God is still in control. And the beauty of this, people of God, is that when nothing has its hands on the clay, clay is in and of itself useless. Clay, when left up to its own devices, can do nothing and can become nothing. And God seeks to convey to Jeremiah that the people of Judah had drifted off and began to do what was right in their own eyes, not remembering that God was still in control. I love this piece of the text because, much like the Israelites, oftentimes we find ourselves in a place where we think we've got it all under control. We come to this place where we try to do things in our own might and in our own strength. We begin to do that which we deem to be right in our own eyes. But what God is communicating here is that we can no more make something of ourselves into anything than a lump of clay can make of itself. In other words, God's word to Jeremiah is this: I am the potter and you are the clay. Without me, you are without shape and without form. But when I put my hands on you, that's when you begin to take shape. That's when you begin to transform into something beautiful. And the principle that I believe God would have Jeremiah's potter house experience to remind us of is that we are in God's very capable hands. We are in the hands of an excellent potter, a potter who makes beautiful things out of nothing. And I just believe that ought to be good news to somebody who knows that with man some things are impossible, but with God all things are possible. I just believe that should be good news to somebody, that the potter has power to transform, to morph, to mold, shape and manipulate that which would have been dry, unshaped, unformed, and unappealing. You see, without the hand of the potter, the clay is nothing. Without the hand of the potter, the clay is worthless. Without the hand of the potter, the clay is dry and run down. But when the potter's hands are in the mix, when the potter's hands are on the clay, that which was once deemed worthless and useless now has the ability to become something full of value and use. Because the potter, our potter, has the ability to transform worthlessness into worthiness. But Jeremiah is watching the potter at the wheel with the clay in hand, literally transforming this worthlessness into worthiness, and there arises a problem. Somebody say there's a problem. People of God, there arises a problem. Jeremiah says it here in verse 4, the A clause, but the pot that the potter was shaping from clay was marred in the potter's hands. Now here lies the problem, people of God. The potter is working at the wheel with the clay in hand, and as the wheel is spinning, the clay comes to ruin. The clay is marred. The clay is cracked. The clay is messed up. Now once more, unworthy to be used. But what I love about the potter is this, that even though the clay is marred, the potter doesn't release the clay. Remember, it's in the hand of the potter that something unworthy becomes something worthy. You've got to keep watching, because in the process of becoming something worthy, the clay has a mishap. The clay in the hands of the potter, the clay on the potter's wheel, the clay in the middle of the transformation process becomes marred. Anybody know what it means to be marred? Anybody know what it means to be messed up, cracked up, and unfit? That is this clay's reality. And in case you haven't gotten it by now, the clay is symbolic of us. And every now and again, in the process of becoming what God would have us to become, we encounter some missteps, some mishaps, and some mistakes. Somewhere along the way, we become marred and unworthy and unfit to be used. But God, somebody say, but God. But God, our excellent potter, is faithful and patient, even when we've encountered some cracks and imperfections along the way. God is faithful not to take God's hands off of us. Don't miss this. It doesn't matter how badly you've messed up. Doesn't matter how many mistakes you made. Doesn't matter how miserably you failed. God is not in the business of throwing God's people away. The potter makes their living from the clay. So instead of wasting resources, look at what the potter does. Jeremiah says, so the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best. And I love this, people of God, because the truth of the matter is you're never too broken, too dented, too messed up, too mangled, too stained, too marred, too ruined to be cleaned up, fixed up, reshaped, reformed, and repaired by the grace and the mercy of our very patient potter. And somebody should have shouted right there, because you know that if the truth be told, you've made more mistakes than you care for anybody to talk about. And you know that your second chance should have passed a long time ago. And you know how messed up you used to be. And you know how messed up you still are today. But thanks be unto God that we serve a God of another chance. Somebody ought to take just a few seconds to shout, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for looking beyond my faults. Thank you, Lord, for not giving up on me. Thank you, Lord, for not throwing me away with yesterday. Today's trash. Thank you, Lord, for not doing to me what others might have done to me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for keeping your hands on me even when I was marred. But then there's the process. The problem is that the clay is marred, the clay is messed up, the clay is cracked. But the beauty is that the potter doesn't discard the clay. No, the potter simply begins to reshape and repair the clay from something unworthy back into something worthy. God's process, God's systematic mechanism is quite similar to that of the potter. The potter, realizing that the clay is marred, has to then reshape and reform and repair the clay by adding some water to it and reapplying pressure to smooth out some of the rough edges. And in the same way, God uses the circumstances of our life to mold us into vessels that are worthy of honor. Listen, while the potter is adding water and reapplying pressure, the clay is on the wheel going around in circles. And I believe that God uses some of the cyclical seasons and circumstances of our life to bring about change. In order for the potter to make the pot, the clay has to keep moving. He's got to keep spinning. And for somebody, you may have felt like you've been going through patterns and cycles. You feel like you keep running up on the same problems, tests, and trials. But I've stopped by to serve notice that when God is working us through the process, when God is reshaping and reforming us, when God is repairing and remaking us, sometimes God chooses to send us through the spin cycle. Anybody know what it means to go through the spin cycle? Around and around and around and around, and it seems like it just won't end. I've come to encourage somebody that the spin cycle is only temporary. The circular and cyclical seasons and circumstances of our lives don't last forever. God simply has to spin you around and make sure all of the edges on all sides of the clay have been smoothed over. God simply spins us around and make sure that no part of us goes without attention. God spins us around to ensure that the clay has been thoroughly transformed. Completely transformed from worthlessness to worthiness. God spins us around to ensure that we are now vessels worthy of honor. And so we have this principle: God is our sovereign potter. There is a problem that we are marred clay. We undergo this process, a transformative season of reshaping and renewal. But before Jeremiah's experience at the potter's house is complete, God offers Jeremiah a glimpse of the final product. The Bible says that as Jeremiah arrives at the potter, at the house of the potter is working at the wheel. And as the potter is working, the clay becomes marred in the potter's hand. So the potter, being patient with the clay, begins to reform it, because watch this, the potter had a vision for what the clay would eventually look like. Listen. God sees where we have the potentiality of being, even when the people around us can't see it. Even when the people around us can only look at us in our present state, in our marred condition, Jeremiah could only see marred clay. Jeremiah could only see messed up and cracked clay, but the potter sees a vision of what the clay could be. And so the potter has this specific goal, this specific design and pattern for the clay pot. So the potter reshapes it and reforms it. Our potter, our God, forms us and then God reforms us. God shapes us and reshapes us. God prepares us and God repairs us, not based off of what others see, but based off of the vision that God has for what we will one day be. And so I heard the songwriter say, please be patient with me, because God is not through with me yet. Because when God gets through with me, I shall come forth like pure gold. And I come to serve. Notice that doesn't matter what your present position might be. God is working on you. God is matriculating you through the process. So when people look at you funny or look at you strange, you walk to declare, I'm in God's transformation process. And I'm a work in progress. God isn't done with me yet. God's not done shaping me yet. God's not done bringing about God's full purpose in me yet. But like the Apostle Paul, I'm confident in this, that the God who began a good work in me shall bring it to completion in the day of Christ Jesus. I know I'm messed up. I know I made some mistakes. I know I've had some mishaps, but I know that God's hands are still on me. And since I know that God's hands are still on me, I need you to be patient with me. I need you to bear with me for just a little while, because God is sifting me. God is reforming me. God is renewing me. God is reshaping me. God is preparing me. God is rejuvenating me. God is restoring me. God's getting ready to elevate me. God is working on me. And I know that when I come forth, I'm coming out like pure gold. And I'm getting ready to take my seat, but I can't leave that piece of clay on the potter's wheel. Because people of God, I come to serve. Notice that after the potter has shaped the clay, the potter removes it from the wheel and sets it in the fire. The potter sets the clay in the fire so that it hardens and becomes durable and usable. The fire, I believe, is one of the most uncomfortable stages of the potter's process. The heat gets turned up and the clay's ability to withstand the test of times are examined. And just like the clay, God has to take us through the fire. But don't be dismayed when you encounter the fire. The fire is the place wherein God hardens the clay and strengthens the clay, because God can't use clay that hasn't been through the fire. But here's the good news. Here's the good news. When archaeologists go and study ancient sites, they begin excavating those sites. And inevitably, these men and women, they don't find many human remains. No, they decay over time. They don't find a lot of money and currency. It decays over time. But one thing that they always find in an archaeological site that has survived through the ages are pieces of pottery. Because what the potter makes and sends through the fire can stand the test of time. What the potter makes and sends through the fire can endure the storms that come. What the potter makes and sends through the fire is built to last. And I don't know about anybody else, but I'm glad that I find myself on the potter's wheel. And I'm glad that in my marred state, the potter didn't give up on me. And I'm so glad that the potter reformed and reshaped me into what the potter would have me to be. And I'm so glad today that the potter sent me through the fire, because in the fire I gained durability. In the fire I gained sustainability. In the fire I learned a little bit about longevity. And I'm so glad this morning that the potter never gave up on me. And I'm so glad today that the potter never discarded me. And so even though I've been through the fire and I've been through the flood, I can testify that I'm standing here only because of the blood. Might have had some good days, had some hills to climb, might have even had some weary days and some sleepless nights. But I'm so glad that I can testify through it all, God kept me. Through it all, God was with me. And through it all, I learned how to trust in Jesus. Hymn writer says it like this: 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to know the Savior's promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. The word of God for the people of God. This time we would like to extend an invitation to each of you, those of you in the sanctuary, those of you watching in our virtual space. I'm going to give you a few call words, and if you hear the call that is for you, if you hear God moving on your heart to respond today, if you're in the sanctuary, just raise your hand. If you are in the virtual space, I'll give you a few words to type to respond to us. The first call we want to extend to you is that if you don't know this Jesus that I just talked about, if you don't know this potter that is able to take that which is unworthy and to make it beautiful and worthy, if you don't know this God, we invite you into relationship with God today. God has opened his arms to you. God has opened the door for you to come in. God loves you. God cares for you. Doesn't matter what you've been through. Doesn't matter where you're at right now. God is saying, come home, come unto me and rest. So if you'd like to be saved, we ask that you just pray this simple prayer with us. God, I know I'm messed up. I know I'm like marred clay on the potter's wheel. But you are a gracious and a merciful potter. And you have invited me to come back to relationship with you, to love you, to honor you, to trust you, to read your word, to pray, and to be in relationship with you. God, you said that you would forgive us of our sins. So I say I'm sorry for what I've done. But God, I know that you are waiting to welcome me with open arms. So I thank you that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, and that because I believe in that, I'm saved. If you just prayed that prayer of salvation, we need you to type in the chat, I did it. If you prayed that prayer of salvation here in the sanctuary, just raise your hand. Secondly, if you've been wandering, if you were in the potter's process and you became like that clay, marred and ruined in the middle of your process, might have walked away from God, might have turned your back on God, God is saying, you don't have to stay that way. God is saying, I'm here, I'm ready and available. Come home, come back to your first love. If that's for you today, just type, I'm back. Say this prayer with me. God, I know I messed up. I know I went astray. I know I tried to do what was right in my own eyes. But I thank you for your forgiveness and for your love and for your grace and your mercy. And I thank you that I can come back today. If you just prayed that prayer, you are back. Type in the chat, I'm back. I've rededicated my life. I'm ready to once more engage in a relationship with God. And finally, if you'd like to be a part of the Love AME Church family, if you'd like to be a love agent where we love God, where we love ourselves, and where we love our community, we invite you to type in the chat, sign me up, and somebody will be in contact with you. There's also a link somewhere in the chat that you can type to become more involved and further connected here with the Love family. That's all we have for you today, brothers and sisters. I want to say a prayer over each and every one of us before we lead into our benediction. Let's pray. God, we thank you. We thank you for what our eyes have seen, for what our ears have heard, for what our hearts have felt today. God, you have been here in our midst. You have visited us here in your sanctuary. You have visited us in our virtual sanctuary. You have given us a word that, Lord, transformation can take place. We simply have to trust that our very patient potter has your hands on us. Keep your hands on us, God. Keep molding us and shaping us and reforming us into who you would have us to be. And God, we'll be ever careful to give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to thank you again for worshiping here with us today at Love AME Church in Largo, Maryland, where Pastor Chris Natiston is the pastor. We invite you to come back and join us next week. Please stand for our benediction if you're in the sanctuary, wherever you are. I hear this benediction today. Moses said unto Aaron, and Aaron said unto his sons, and should have also said unto his daughters, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make the divine face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift the divine countenance upon you and give you peace. Henceforth, now, and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next week.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me. Waiting for change to come, knowing the best. Still you have never failed me, no. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faith.